Good evening. This year, Minnesota elects a United States Senator. The race for that office is heating up. The two front runners have been throwing negative TV spots at one another, but in a few minutes, they will meet face to face in the first of two scheduled debates. There are very few ground rules governing tonight's debate. I'm the moderator, Steve Young. There will be no podiums, no stopwatches, no limits on follow-up questions to the candidates, who have no idea what specific questions will be asked. One restriction, however, limited the number of candidates who were asked to appear. Only those candidates who could demonstrate the support of at least 15% of the electorate in a poll taken shortly before the debate were invited. Incumbent Senator David Durenberger and Minnesota's Attorney General Hubert Humphrey III met that requirement and are with us tonight. Join us for the next 90 minutes as we explore the issues facing the electorate with Minnesota's leading candidates for the U.S. Senate on We the People, Minnesota's senatorial debate.
Services Company, Winthrop and Weinstein, providing legal services and business counseling to businesses, financial institutions, and individuals. And by the St. Paul Pioneer Press Dispatch for in-depth coverage of local, state, and national politics.
To hold this debate here in St. Paul's wonderful renovated World Theater, we have received financial support from some very special firms and individuals. IDS Financial Services, St. Paul Pioneer Press Dispatch, Minnesota Power, Gerald Kafestian, Fagry and Benson, and Mona Meyer and McGrath. Tonight's debate will be different from the highly structured recent confrontations between presidential and vice presidential candidates. Tonight there will be no journalists asking questions. Rather, we hope to facilitate a conversation among the senatorial candidates and five Minnesota citizens. Listening to that informal discussion will give you, the voter, an opportunity to study the character and the habits of speech and thought of these two candidates. Five citizens will help us present the topics and the questions to the candidates. Now, to ensure that the topics under discussion tonight reflect the concerns of the voters and not political professionals, we held town meetings all around the state last week. In these meetings, dozens of citizens were asked to reflect on the issues that were important to them. Three large topics were decided upon: federal deficit, our foreign policy, and the quality of life. What can we afford? Now, our participants in these town meetings had seen many of the campaign ads put on by both campaigns, but they said they wanted to know much more about the issues and where the candidates stood on specifics. Now, this is something I spoke to both candidates with just on Saturday. Let's take a look now at what the candidates...
It's the dirtiest campaign we've seen in Minnesota and probably in the history of the state in a statewide election. Here we are within, you know, several weeks of the election, and I still can't figure out who Skip Humphrey is. I can watch all of his commercials. I can listen to all of his speeches. And a lot of other people can have listened to everything he said for the last 2 years that he's been running, and you still can't figure out who he is. He's been in public life for 16 years, and we're still trying to figure out who is he.
This campaign is on the record, the congressional record, the record that has been created by my opponent, my Republican opponent, and his administration. It's really a choice. You know, I'm not going to vote to let those plea bargaining go with Noriega. I am going to say no to that. When the choice comes to vote for Star Wars and B-1 bombers versus cutting Medicare, I'm going to make sure that Medicare is not cut.
Senator, you don't like the campaign ads of Mr. Humphrey, but one of the prices you have to pay for being in public life is to have your record looked at, criticized, and picked over. Is your criticism of his campaign fair?
Well, I think so. If you're looking at the candidate on whom you have to make a decision to represent you for 6 years, you ought to look at what that person has done over a long period of time.
You ought to put it in the context of the person. You put it in the context of a voting record. You put it in the context, in my case, of literally thousands of speeches and a variety of other appearances all over this state. You put it in the context of the forums I've held all over the state of Minnesota, the issues that I've gotten involved in, the accomplishments, if you will, that have been recognized by people all over this country. And you don't sort of grab off one out of 4,000 votes, or six out of 4,000, or three out of 4,000, or whatever the case may be, and characterize the candidate.
But you did vote the way the Humphrey ads allege you voted, did you not?
No, you can drag. The clever thing about these commercials, and they've been done in other campaigns in other years by the kind of people that are advising them. The clever thing about it is you can pull out the congressional record, and you can say, here is a vote that was 60 votes here and 30 votes there. But that doesn't translate into the conclusion that his commercial draws from that I cut Medicare or I cut the school lunch program. Nobody's cut school lunch or Medicare in the 10 years I've been in the Senate.
Mr. Attorney General, tit for tat, doesn't the senator have a point that it really is easy to take out one or two minor things and take them out of context and try to create an emotional atmosphere in a campaign which is not really relevant?
Well, of course, there are many votes that an individual will have to make in their public career, decisions that have to be made. But the record that we've shown are the critical votes. And David, you know very well that vote in May of 1985 on the raising of the wasteful spending in military versus that cut in Medicare was a critical vote. It was a vote in which you cast the deciding decision. It was a vote that made the choice as to which direction we would go, whether it was with the Reagan administration's policies of more wasteful military spending or supporting Medicare. When I'm the United States Senator,
Mr. Attorney General,
I'm going to support Medicare.
Could I ask you,
Can I tell him he's absolutely right, except for the last half of it?
Absolutely. I'd like to get some agreement between both of you.
I mean, the reality is it was a directional vote. There's no question. This is the most famous vote anybody's taken in the last 8 years. It was a 50-49 vote in which one of our colleagues got pulled in on a gurney out of a hospital bed where he just had his appendix removed. And the vote was all about a balanced budget by the year 1990. That's what that vote was all about.
So your position is that they're taking it out of context.
Of course they are.
That vote was all about whether you were for more Star Wars, for more wasteful military spending, or whether you were going to support the reinvestment of our people in health care, in housing, and in many of the other programs.
I was there, it was 1:30 in the morning, and it was all about the budget, about balancing the budget in 1990. A lot of people were present at that time, and only one Democrat voted for it, and good old Ed Zirinsky, and he passed on.
Mr. Attorney General, I feel a need to ask you that these issues, which we're going to talk about tonight and are in the campaign, are tough, complicated issues. There are no easy answers. And isn't it just possible that in the tough fight of a campaign, you do want to oversimplify, and you take a complicated thing like our budget deficit and say, well, this is a simple trade-off between Star Wars and Medicaid? Now, is that really a responsible way to push these issues before the people?
Indeed, that is exactly what the choice was. This was the Reagan agenda, ironed out between the majority of Republicans, including my opponent, in the Senate and the Reagan administration, and it was their keen interest to see a cutback on those people programs and to invest in the Star Wars. And by the way, I hear my opponents say so that we could have the budget balanced by 1990. We're sure not on that agenda, are we? We've had a budget. One of the problems that we have here is that we've made the wrong choices. We've got to make new choices to meet that new world of competition out there. And the way we're going to get at that is to reinvest in the human capital of this country. That's our people. We can't do that if we're going to spend money on Star Wars or B-1 bombers that don't fly or MX missiles that we don't need.
What we need to be able to do instead is to put it into students and kids and farmers and people who need housing. That's what's going to make us a stronger country.
And these were the issues. These were the issues which came up in our town meetings. And I think now let's take a look at what some of the citizens said in our meetings about the problem of the budget deficit.
Whenever we spend $30,000 per soldier, the federal government spends that much, and $455 per child for education. In my view, those priorities are mixed up.
Can we reasonably expect to get rid of the deficit in our lifetime? Is there a good old boy system going that trades one piece of pork for another piece of pork in the barrel that it's never going to happen?
Mr. Attorney General, are the things you want to do the kind of things that Doris is talking about? You're going to trade some pieces of pork for other pieces of pork? I'd like to ask, which is more important for you, reducing the deficit or finding funds for the social programs you just mentioned?
Well, first of all, I'm not going to be trading pork for pork. I think what we have to do is decide what the important priorities are and to spend our dollars, not more dollars, but to spend our dollars better, to spend them more wisely. And that's why I call for the fact that we need to change our priorities in Washington, that we have to change the way that we're spending that money and spend it better and more wisely. Now, you asked the question of whether we can raise or we can settle that debt and reduce that deficit or have those programs. I think we can do both. We can make the right choices, be more efficient, manage our budget better, and at the same time apply the resources that have been wasted so flagrantly in these last 8 years and put them back into something that will give us a good investment and a good return on that investment. You know, let me give you an example. $1 in Head Start, a program which my opponent has voted against, $1 in Head Start could save us $6 down the road in social costs. That's the kind of wise investment that we need to make.
Senator, you have spent a lot of time talking and researching some of these very tough, complicated issues. I take it you don't agree with the Attorney General that there are easy and simple solutions of shifting priorities from one to another and reducing the deficit at the same time.
No, I heard not the first time, obviously, a very political answer that says we can do both. I mean, whenever people are faced with choices, particularly if you're not an incumbent and have to make the decisions, it's easy to say we can do both. The reality is that when you're there and you actually have to take every one of those votes, every time you make one of these votes, you are making choices. You can't ever have it both ways. You can't vote aye nay at the same time. You're either aye or nay, and you have to give somebody some sense of direction.
How do you propose, however, dealing with the deficit and putting money into some of the things that you feel we need to attend to?
Well, it depends on how you view the deficit, and I think that's what this whole program is going to be all about. As we listen to the questions here, it's all going to be about how much can we have, how many of our needs can we satisfy in this country, and how are we going to pay for it, individually, collectively, and so forth. The reality today is, thanks to what we've accomplished in the last few years, that if you just want a fiscally balanced budget, you want the checkbook kind of a budget so that the income and the outgo equal each other, you're going to have it by the year 1993. You've got the kind of healthy economy in this country. You've got inflation down. You've got spending down. You've got the interest rates down. You've got employment up. You've got everything in place that you can balance that budget in a fiscal sense. Our problems are generational problems. They're how do you keep that thing balanced? How do you continue to have this country meet the problems that develop over time and still find the resources that society is willing to pay for it? That's what this discussion tonight, I hope, is all about.
A quick response, and then I want to ask about taxes. And then...
Well, I just hear, this is what you hear in that Washington rhetoric. Everything is comfortable. Everything is okay. Let's just kind of keep it on the same vein. And while we sit out here in Minnesota, we've seen 12,000 farm families forced off the land. We know that we've got to get our children ready for the future. We're fighting a war on drugs, and we haven't had the help of the federal government in the way that we need to have it in order to keep our neighborhoods safe and secure. I hear the point of my opponent when he says, well, we can balance the budget and we have to make these choices. But the choice that was made in 1985 was, okay, to balance the budget. How? By raising that wasteful military spending and cutting Medicare to senior citizens. balance the budget on the backs of the senior citizens.
Mr. Attorney General.
When I'm United States Senator, I'm not going to balance that budget that way.
I would like to ask you that if eliminating the deficit is so vital, why should we have any sacred cows, including Medicaid, including Social Security? Shouldn't every American pay something to get out from our national debt?
Well, as I said before, I think it's very important that we make the right choices. If we want to balance our budget, one of the most important elements of accomplishing that as soon as possible is a growing and robust economy. To balance it on the back of senior citizens, many of whom may very well be needed to meet the labor shortage that is predicted all over the place, or the funding of our educational system, our college student loans and programs, our child care programs, those are all wise investments to allow our economy to grow and become stronger, which will help us balance that
budget. Senator, how can we make hard choices when our political system has become fragmented and is dominated now by causes and special interests? When push comes to shove, no program ever seems to get cut.
Well, let me first go back to one of these comments to lay the groundwork for it. Before anybody out there in this audience or the audience that's watching us thinks that somehow or other we have balanced the budget or got the economy healthy on the backs of senior citizens, let me tell you that the one commercial that's on the air right now that has fact in it is the one that indicates that we have increased Medicare spending in this country by $500 billion for the 32 million Medicare recipients. We restored the Social Security system to solvency, and it's going to be solvent for the next 50, 60 years without raising payroll taxes. We did all of the things that needed to get done to help ensure that we would no longer poverty the elderly in that country, in this country. And that is the kind, you know, you don't do that because the seniors are a powerful lobby. You do that because each of us has parents that we care a lot about, and we have a society about whom we are proud. And that's the record of the last 8 years. It is not a matter of making choices.
A quick response from the Attorney General, and then we'll go to our questioners.
I would just say that time and again, my opponent has voted against the COLAs, the cost of living increases, the things that help each senior citizen make and meet their daily needs. We have to understand that when the choices were there to be made, the choices was to raise that wasteful military spending and to cut back on all of these people.
But that's a new line. The ads say cuts. Now he says he's voting to freeze COLAs. He said he'd vote to freeze COLAs. Claude Pepper voted to freeze COLAs. Lloyd Benson voted to freeze COLAs. Responsible people do that. What, you know, if it's necessary to get a greater good for those same elderly people, lick inflation, bring their interest rates down, save the value of their savings. That's why you do that sort of thing, and everybody does it, Democrats and Republicans.
Thank you. Now we'll turn to citizens who are neither Democrats nor Republicans as far as we know. I'd like to introduce our panel of questioners this evening. First, we have Darlene Radical, a homemaker from Mankato, George Sundstrom, a union worker from Duluth, Rose from Rochester, I apologize, I forgot your last name, a little nervous. Rose was a teacher and she now works in the private sector. And Maren Steven, who is a senior at Minneapolis South High School, and Joe Abdo, who is a businessman and CPA in Mankato. And I apologize. George, I think you had a question on the deficit.
Attorney General, Senator, I'm glad to be able to be here this evening. Over the past 8 years, this country has gone from the greatest debtor nation in the world to the greatest creditor nation in the world. The other way around. Don't feel lonely.
Not quite true, but that's what a lot of people say.
Isn't that good? We've seen defense spending up. Inflation has been able to be kept down, and I think a lot of our people are looking at that. The reason for that is because of a lot of increased foreign investment in the United States. If we increase defense spending, and at the same time allow increased foreign investment in land and industry in the United States, is that in the best national interest of this country?
Senator, and then the Attorney General.
Yeah, first on the question of defense spending being up, it is up, there's no question about it, but I asked somebody today to give me the figures on what Jimmy Carter recommended before he left office, and the reality is he laid out a five-year plan that had higher defense spending in it by fiscal 86 than we actually appropriated in fiscal 86. Inflation down, we all know that. Inflation in 1978, 79, and 80, the last 3 years of the Carter administration totaled 35%. And that's what laid the groundwork for this huge deficit, 35% in just 3 years. Now, the foreign investment, and that's very appropriate. You've got a steel company or an ore company up there now that's owned by a foreign company. We're listening to the possibility of a British company taking over a Minnesota name, you know, that's very famous. And a lot of people at the State Fair this year, I'm sure, have asked both of us about the question of foreign investment. I think there's two sides to that. First, it's awful good news that all of those people want to invest in the United States. It says something about our economy, our political system, and everything else. Land and paper, for example, is owned now by a New Zealand company. It's called British Columbia Paper. They're in their seventh expansion. They're adding jobs all over northern Minnesota. So that the test really is, will foreign ownership disrupt the community, take jobs away from the community? And one of the records has been that it's usually American companies acquiring other American companies just for the money involved that causes people to lose jobs rather than this foreign investment. But we do have laws in place in which we track foreign investment. The SEC tracks it. And if there's ever any danger in this country, we still control this country at large.
Thank you. Mr. Attorney General.
I think we have to be concerned about the rising level of foreign investment in this country. I think it's a clear indication. It's a clear indication of the direction that is going. Why are they investing here? It's because we have such a deep debt. It's because we are not able to move our own goods and commodities overseas. What we need is an aggressive, results-oriented trade policy. We need fair rules in the trade so that we can continue to allow our businesses to grow. You know, they've been being beat up by the foreign competition. We've got to make certain that the right choices are made so that we have an aggressive, results-oriented, fair trade policy to allow for businesses to grow and to have those employees continue to have good jobs at good wages. The new jobs that have been coming on, I hear my opponents sounding again comfortable about everything is. Almost half of the new jobs in this country are below poverty wage. Now, what are we doing when we invite people to get a job and find out that they can't even maintain a level of income that would bring them above the poverty line?
Thank you.
That's not adding to the strength of our country.
Darlene?
Yes, Senator and Attorney General, I'd like to ask you, it seems to me what you're saying tonight is that the deficit will take care of itself by 1990?
No.
No, absolutely not.
Attorney General first and then Senator.
I think there are four things that we must do right away. Absolutely, at least four things. First of all, we can reduce the wasteful military spending by some $40 billion at least. That's what the procurement officers of the Pentagon say is right there every single year. Secondly, we can make more efficient and effective our own domestic programs and reduce those and still do a better job of serving the people. Third, we can ask for a greater sharing of that defense burden by all of the allies in the free world. And we can also ask for and have a good, solid tax collection effort that's going to pick up some of the revenues. There's over $100 billion a year that are not collected of taxes that are due and owing to us. So we, as taxpayers, have to take on that additional burden. I know that with that additional effort, we can make a significant drop in that deficit. And we can also make the right choices with the dollars that we have raised. We can add value.
Senator, a brief response? Every second of clapping is a second less for marvelous statements from our candidate.
There's a couple of solutions there I'd like to show you the other side of, but let's just stick with, is reducing the deficit something that's automatic? No, it's not. It's a lot of hard work, but it's a lot more than just taking money out of a program you don't like and putting it into a program you do like. If you look at things like what does 1% drop in the interest rate mean to federal spending, it's something like $21 billion over 2 years. If you look at what driving down unemployment will mean to federal spending in this country, it's something over 2 years in the neighborhood of $30 billion if you'd reduce it by 1%. So whichever way you look at it,
keeping this healthy economy of ours, which he says I feel comfortable. I feel very comfortable about it, because when I got here, it was in a shambles, and now it is, yes, it is, it's in very good shape. But keeping that going makes it possible for us not only to balance the budget, which is what we're talking about here, but it makes us possible to address a lot of the issues that both of us care about, that we're going to talk about tonight, that we haven't yet provided either a local, state, federal, or a private sector solution to.
Thank you, but I must say, I didn't hear either of you answer Darlene's question by giving us a date when the budget is going to disappear. Do you have a date, Senator?
Well, yes, it's September 30th, right? I mean, the date is built right into the law. We have Graham Rudman Hollings in effect as the forcing mechanism to make it happen. The date is September 30th, 1993.
And you think it's going to happen?
Of course, providing I get reelected.
I want to have
Mr.
it.
Mr. Attorney General?
I want to have that happen at least by then, if not earlier. And I think we can get at it right now. And I don't agree with my opponent who said earlier that he didn't want to talk about the deficit until 1989.
Thank you. Rose, you've got a question, and then Joe.
The Rochester people are very concerned about the deficit. As a matter of fact, it was probably the hottest topic on the table. And the bottom line is, we just want to know what's in store for our future, our children, basically. What can you promise us and make it happen?
Mr. Attorney General, and then Senator.
Well, I would just say this. I've said all throughout this campaign that this campaign is about priorities and choices. But when you see that out of every single dollar of federal income tax, 2 cents goes to education and 55 cents goes to defense, you know something is wrong. We're not really choosing the right concerns, the right programs. I think we need to invest in people. I think we have to have Head Start. I think we need decent child care so that we can have our family members and the parents go to work and be more productive and more competitive. There's a whole new world out there, a world of competition for minds and markets. If we don't invest in those people, if we don't invest in the quality of health care and others, we're not going to get ahead. We're not going to meet that competition. So when I'm your United States Senator, I'm going to be voting to choose those kinds of programs to invest our dollars in.
Senator, I'd like to echo Rose's comment. In all our four meetings, there was an undertone of worry. You may be comfortable in the way the economy is now, but many of our citizens are just worried about the future and the burden of the debt. And do you have an answer for Rose?
Sure, but let me take it out of the context of government programs. I mean, the presumption here so far is we're talking about a federal government that can't live within its means. The reality is, we've got $11 trillion worth of not living within our means in this society right now. And those of you who have shared this problem with me during the course of my being in the United States Senate know that I see it as a matter of values, not a checkbook issue. It's a matter of who today lives within their means and who takes responsibility for their actions, and how do we reinforce that in our society. I think that the sense of problem that I sense out there is the high cost of housing, the high cost of health care, the high cost of education. I worked my way through college. None of my kids can do that anymore. The average, you know, I put down $78 a month, I think, on my first house. Now the average is $938. How did we get there? And you're not going to have a government program that raises your $938. I think that's the problem that I see people trying to deal with when they talk about who is going to help us all to be able to make ends meet.
Thank you, Attorney General.
You know, the point that's made is well taken. It is a matter of values. It is a matter of choices. But we need a person in the United States Senate that's going to make the right choices based on the right values. And David, I can't understand why you would vote to keep that fund for all those newsletters, that franking fund, instead of voting to make sure that that money was transferred for research on Alzheimer's disease and on AIDS. Everyone else did, but two people didn't, and you were one of them.
The other one's name was Humphrey, but it wasn't you.
But that's the wrong choice.
But how could, Senator, how
Let
could
me
you
explain that?
How could you?
I can explain it probably almost in the same way that I'll explain the Noriega vote when he brings that one up as a solution to the drug problem. But
The reality is that was a budget resolution, didn't appropriate any money. It wasn't a matter of cutting money. It wasn't a matter of transferring money. It's one of these hokey things that people do periodically. And in this case, somebody got up and said, let's take $200 million out of the franking privilege, which is what senators use to communicate with people. Nobody likes that anyway. All of the constituents are upset about that sort of thing. Let's take it out of there, and we'll put it into Alzheimer's research, and we'll put it into AIDS research. Well, everybody flocked to vote aye on it. I was angry enough because I'd been very involved in Alzheimer's research, and at that point in time, I was getting involved in AIDS research. And I was angry enough to vote no in terms of a symbolic statement that if you want to do Alzheimer's research, put the money into it you have to put into it. You want to do AIDS research, put the money into it that you have to do. $200 million was a drop in the bucket.
Mr. Attorney General.
Let's talk a little bit about this, because you mentioned the Noriega vote. Let me tell you exactly the circumstance under which I learned about this vote. I had just returned to my office in the Capitol, having met with the Black Ministers Alliance in St. Paul here, with all the black ministers from the metropolitan area, and we were talking about how we could begin to win this war on drugs and how we could pull ourselves together. When I got back to my office, I learned that you and just a few others, and I think there were just a few others that had voted.
Paul Simon, your candidate for President of the United States.
Dan Quayle.
Right.
And others voted.
Right. Well, but it was a few. Voted on a pretty good vote.
If I can just finish,
yeah,
voted to say it was all right to plea bargain with Mr. Noriega. Now, I want you to know that sends the wrong message
to
the people of the world,
and
it sends the wrong message to those young people on the street that we're trying to change their attitudes towards.
Thank you.
So
Senator,
what I'm saying is
that's
the wrong message.
Yeah.
Quick response, and then.
Yeah, I started, as soon as I got out of the Intelligence Committee chairmanship early in 1987, I started the effort to get rid of Noriega. In June of 1987, I put together Jesse Helms. You want to hear it or don't you? Okay. I put together the effort to get rid of Noriega. I had to reach to my left, Ted Kennedy, John Kerry, a lot of people that you know well, Skip, and to my right, Jesse Helms. The kind of thing that nobody had ever done before, to put Jesse Helms and Teddy Kennedy together in common cause. We tried it and with Pinochet, all I got was Kennedy, I couldn't get Helms. But we did it on Noriega. We made this administration change its position on Noriega by the fall, and by last spring, when he finally got indicted, I said, if you can get that guy out of Panama by dropping an indictment you'll never be able to enforce anyway, by gosh, do it. And I had to vote against Bob Dole to do it, because he was doing a political gesture at that time, too.
Thank you. We're going to get to foreign policy, but we're going to have one last question on the deficit. Joe?
As usual, when we're talking about the deficit, it seems like we get away from it in a hurry. But, Senator, I'm going to address this to you, because I thought I heard you say that in 1993, if everything goes as it's supposed to go, we will have the budget balanced.
Yes.
Is that what you said?
You bet.
You didn't say we'd have the deficit to zero.
No, you're not going to have the national debt to zero. You're going
right.
to have
okay.
by
I want,
fiscal
I
1984,
a
which begins.
Right. I just wanted to clarify.
You got
that
income and outgo equaling.
It seemed to me that it was going. There might have been a misconception. Mm-hmm. So then, assuming that the budget won't be balanced until 1993, that means that the deficit is going to be built up through 1993.
The national debt will be, yeah.
The national debt. So now I'm asking you, assuming then again that you're very excellent and you balance the budget throughout for the next 20 years, can we live with that national debt? What happens to us with that national debt?
Senator, yeah. And then a response from the Attorney General.
Sure. The other thing that I didn't take the time in the early to part of this program to explain is that I don't agree that just balancing the budget by 1993 by the track that we're on is the permanent solution to our problem. I said that's the fiscal solution. That avoids the crowding out. We've got the money coming in that we can pay the interest on the debt, and to that extent, it'll get paid off if you continue the movement, this positive movement in the economy. You are going to pay off that debt as it comes due. But that doesn't solve the long-range problem of a country that still can't live within its means and has to, in addition to that, meet all of these new needs that hopefully we're going to talk about tonight.
Thank you.
That's the generational problem.
One sentence is all we can take here.
I've just got to respond, because the question is so well taken. We have to understand the interest on the debt alone from the time that Mr. Reagan took office as president until now has been about $14,500 for every family in America. They have stolen a college education from every single family, and they'll do it again.
Let's return to that.
The point is, we cannot afford that. That is taking away from what we need to invest in, and we absolutely have to reduce that debt.
That's our third topic, paying for the quality of life. Now we need to go to our second topic, which is foreign affairs, which we've already trespassed on. But let's take a look now and see what participants in our town meetings had to say about foreign policy issues.
I'm a free trader, but I want to describe what I think a free trader really should be. And that is that it works both ways. And I think most people would be free traders if they saw true free trade.
It makes it hard to supply products at affordable prices within the United States when the cost of money is high. It certainly makes it hard to compete internationally when our costs are high.
But do we want to go back to conventional, strengthening conventional forces with men out in the field and their tanks and guns, or do we want to rely on the nuclear power as a deterrent?
We've come to be pragmatic about the role of drug trafficking in our foreign policy. It's a shame. It should never have been allowed to happen, but it has.
Thank you. Mr. Attorney General, I'd like to ask you about another South American problem, Nicaragua and the Sandinistas. If the Sandinistas do not in the future respect democratic freedoms and civil rights in that country, how will you aid those Nicaraguans who are struggling for freedoms and civil rights in Nicaragua?
Well, first of all, I'm not going to be supporting any contra aid. Number two, I think we can speak rather bluntly to those in office in Nicaragua and let them know of our security interests. And we can also then begin helping those peaceful forces for change in that whole region. It's not only Nicaragua. What we need to do is to lift up people, to help them find the ways to reach towards democracy. But we don't do it by financing a covert war down there. That's not the way that we need to act. We need to make sure that the Sandinistas know that we do believe in democratic change. And we can certainly help trade unions, churches, and other organizations that are really the kinds of peaceful forces for change that can help move us in that direction.
Mr. Attorney General, if the Sandinistas are indeed a Marxist-Leninist party, we've been wishing for peaceful change in the Soviet Union since 1917, and years later we're just being able to see a little bit of it. Isn't your solution really avoiding the hard nut of the problem? As Cicero said, what can be done against force without force?
I think we can have force without having military weapons. This administration of ours seems to every time that there is any kind of action that has to be taken, it first looks to the military option rather than looking to diplomatic discussion with direct negotiations, with bilateral arrangements. This is a neighborhood in which we can let our neighbors know directly what our interests are. But we don't always have to take out that military gun and say this is the way it's going to be, that we can tell you exactly how it's going to be. The fact is that we can let the Sandinistas know exactly what our own interests are and our security interests, and let them know that we will not let them be violated. But going to the other direction of moving towards peaceful change, supporting the Arias peace plan, those are the kind of efforts that I think will bring about the change that you're talking about.
Thank you. Senator, on the same general topic, you don't support President Reagan's contra aid. You don't support the Sandinistas. I'd like to ask you, is there really a viable middle way, or have you just kind of backed away from an unpopular presidential policy which many of your constituents don't like?
I think that's a terrific question. I think a lot of people are trying to figure out right now what is going on in Washington on this whole. I have never been in the middle of an issue that was so poorly understood and so badly mishandled. And the good news, I guess, and what I heard Skip say and what you're asking me is that this administration isn't going to be here starting in January to deal with the problem. And I say that because, despite the fact I have a great deal of respect for this president and the administration in a lot of other areas, their Central American policy has been a failure from the beginning.
I've spoken...
Do you have something that's going to work?
Yes. Well, collectively, we need to come up with something. The first is a set of principles. And I've articulated and re-articulated them. The first, it's a regional problem. It isn't just Nicaragua. It's a regional problem. It must be dealt with in a regional sense. Secondly, it is at heart economic and social. It's not political. The communists are there from Cuba. They're there from the East Bloc countries just to take advantage of a neglected economic and social problem. And the third thing we have to do, and here I suppose is the key to the other two, we have the Kissinger Commission Jackson Plan in place to help with the economic. We've got to get the bipolar investment in that part of the world out. That means the Soviet Union and the United States. Our role as the two great powers is to support a change in each of those countries to democracy. And that's the real answer to the problem.
On Saturday, I asked our candidates in a general way to tell us something about their basic foreign policy views. Let's take a look now at what they told me.
Look what's happening on Wall Street and the insider trading. Look what's happening now with our war against drugs. How come we can fight it at home here and I can have an active alliance against drug program here in Minnesota and we can try and stop the demand here, but we send people to Washington and they don't seem to understand that this is a war, that there is fighting and dying going on in our streets, in our neighborhoods. We need to have people who will constantly have their mind on home.
Condoning a Marcos because he's our friend, condoning a Noriega because he's our friend, condoning a Pinochet because he's our political friend, does not make the United States any more nationally secure. Because whether it's drugs or it's communist insurgents or it's the inability of a democracy to evolve in a country, our condoning dictators of any kind is antithetical to the national security interests of this country.
Thank you. I'd like to ask both of you, Mr. Attorney General, first, why does it seem easier to apply human rights standards to regimes of the right and less so to regimes of the left, such as Ethiopia, Vietnam?
Well, I think that, first of all, one of the key points in the strength of our foreign policy must be a deep concern for human rights. Whether or not it's to the right or to the left, we need to have a steady standard that will require those that we deal with, those that we come in contact with, to understand that human rights in America is a very, very important thing. I don't think that we should be applying them one way or the other on either side. It should be a matter of principle for us.
Senator?
I think I can tell you why it's easier. If you put it in the context of when these regional dictators became powers, it was really it began during the Vietnam period and it reached its flower in the 1970s. The struggle between the Soviet Union and China at that time and the United States for these emerging nations. Angola is one of our best examples, in which in effect the Chinese faction ended up controlling the country. We were forced to take sides. And so we take sides with our friends, so to speak. That turns out to be the right. That's the history of it, and that's why it seems to you that it's easier for us to do that, because it's in the context of the bipolar conflict with the Soviet Union.
Thank you. And now I'd like to take a question from Rose for one of our candidates, or both.
For both. Certainly, foreign policy covers a great deal of territory, and I've gotten a lot from what you've said so far. But there is one other area that does enter the minds of a lot of us, and that is your position, Senator. I'd like you to start with that, on South Africa.
Yeah, there's several ways to look at South Africa. One is internally, and that's the one, the apartheid, that turns an American into an enemy, if you will, of the way in which the current government has been practicing its particularly brutal form of racial discrimination. And again, if we want to hold ourselves out as an ideal to the rest of the world, nobody lives with apartheid. The second part of it is in terms of national security and the black nations around South Africa, particularly now South African occupation of Namibia. What we did in 1985 and 1986 is force the administration to enforce sanctions against South Africa. That was 2 years ago. They're in place now. And nobody says that there's been a great deal of change in apartheid. But there is change in the political arrangement, in not only in that country, but as it relates to the surrounding countries. South Africa is now at the table bargaining in Angola, bargaining with regard to Namibia. I don't oppose additional sanctions on South Africa. And when they come, whether it's now, the Democrats on our side haven't brought it up in the Senate, whenever they come, though, it better be bipartisan. It better be Republicans, Democrats, the administration, the Congress, because when we do it, we better let the government in South Africa know we mean business.
Mr. Attorney General.
I think we need to support strong sanctions against South Africa. We have to send the message that we cannot stand for apartheid, that it is something that we are absolutely opposed to. But what we also need to understand is that this administration's program of constructive engagement has been a failure. What we need to have is to have a cooperative effort of many nations bringing about these sanctions so that in fact they do have an impact. I agree that we haven't had enough of that impact, but we haven't had an administration and we haven't had those who support this administration do enough at the United Nations or in any other area to see that we in fact have a cooperative effort worldwide that lets South Africa know that they cannot continue to exist in the way in which they are operating.
Thank you. Joe?
You know, when we, I think that the foreigners look at the American as being somebody that they might be able to hustle.
Might be able to what?
Be able to hustle or con. We go over, you know, when you go as a traveler, you go to Europe, they're going to sell you the fake Gucci's and the fake Rolexes and so on. And I begin to feel that the foreign government sort of work with the American government the same way. I specifically wonder about the Japanese, whose economy is robust and can well afford to spend the money, and so dependent on oil coming through the Straits of Hormuz. And yet the United States Navy, and even at a loss of life, has to go in there and protect those tankers to keep countries like Japan going. My question is, do we make them reimburse us for that? And if we don't, why not?
Senator first, and then Mr. Attorney General.
Yeah. You're right, Joe, in stating the realities of the dependence of the Japanese on particularly Iranian oil. This is a long-term dependent. And you're also right about the fact that the United States unilaterally moved into the Gulf. But the reality is, if we were going to open up a business, national defense is a business, and before we sent the Navy to the Gulf or we sent the Army to Grenada or something, we checked to see whether who was going to benefit and how much we were going to charge them. You couldn't do international diplomacy and you couldn't do national security. We had to act in our best interest, and it happened also to be in the best interest of the Japanese, the British, the Europeans, a lot of other people. What happened because of that? And a lot of us had questions in the beginning about what was the president doing. But the reality is, he brought to an end this war between Iran and Iraq, which has been on for the last 9 years, and began the process now, hopefully, in the next administration, Republican or Democrat, of stabilizing the Middle East, stabilizing oil prices, and stabilizing the world economic. So it was an important thing for
taking
us.
Taking a lot of credit for the administration, Senator. Mr. Attorney General?
You know, I want to get back to the point that you're making, and I think it's an appropriate point. Our businesses are getting beat up by the foreign competition. This government stands back and just lets everything come rolling in, and we've lost jobs because of that. We've had problems all the way down the line in meeting that competition. I think it's about time we stand up and say, yeah, fair trade is okay. I mean, free trade is okay, but how about some fair trade? How about making sure that we have the same standards applied here, applied elsewhere? I think that's what we absolutely need to do. And certainly, we need to be asking those who get a benefit from our defense and our military action to protect those seaways to have a response and to pay for some of that. In fact, I think that the first action shouldn't have been to jump in there, as my opponent says, unilaterally. We should have been asking the British and the French and the Japanese and those others who had a very keen interest what they were going to do to participate in this effort. It's about time that we share these costs of defense of the free world.
Mr. Attorney General, I'd like to follow up with you on, it seems to me that this year a number of people in the Democratic Party are taking a tougher line on protectionism and retaliating against particularly the Japanese than some others. In the 1930s, the Americans had a very sort of tough policy against the Japanese, and that, some scholars feel, encouraged their militarism and set up, in some sense, World War II. Don't we run the risk with this kind of trade policy of encouraging Japanese nationalism yet again when they're not too far away from a nuclear capacity if they ever wanted to do it?
Well, you know, we're not talking about protectionism here. We're talking about fair trade. We're talking about just exactly what I do in the Attorney General's office. If there's a problem between two individuals, we investigate what that problem is. We try and find out where the differences are. Then we ask, when we find out those differences, how can we resolve that? And if we can't resolve it, we take the action that's necessary. That's exactly what we need to do with our trade policy. We need to investigate where those trade discrepancies are. If we find out that they're rooted in a problem in the other country, let's ask that it be fixed and that it be changed. And if it isn't changed, then let's take the action that will continue to open up the markets. That's what we have to have, an opportunity to open up these markets.
Thank you. Marin.
I'd like to move on to a slightly larger idea. Senator Durenberger referred earlier to the U.S. as a great power, and what I'd like to find out is what are each of your opinions on the future role of the U.S. as a world power, and do you think our influence will increase or decrease in the coming years, and do we need to be number one or number two in the non-communist world?
Mr. Attorney General and then Senator.
I certainly think that we are going to be increasing our influence. The goal of our foreign policy is to see that our American ideals are pursued throughout the world. And we can do that with a growing and robust economy. We do that, of course, with a strong defense. But our problem is that we have to make certain that we're ready to meet that competition out there that I've talked about, ready to meet that future. Right now, we're not investing in the human capital of our society. We're falling behind in that area. We need to make sure that each individual is ready to meet that opportunity of a good job at a good salary. And we're not seeing that when we are not investing in education and in the other needs that are going to make us ready. You know, we've got a situation where a quarter of the individuals that will be graduating from high school in the year 2000 are not going to be able to read and write. That's not going to make us ready for the future. If we really want to be strong, we've got to invest in our human capital.
Thank you. Senator?
I think what you're asking about is influence in a positive sense, because whether you're the captain of the debate team or you're the class president or whatever it is, if you are that, it's because you have an influence. You have some kind of positive feelings that you have generated in your classmates. And I think that same thing applies to nation states. I mean, if this country is number one, not because it makes the biggest bombers or the most fancy bombs or has a Burger King or a McDonald's or something like that on every corner. It's because for 200 years we have lived with a constitution the likes of which nobody has anywhere in the world. I mean, it is the freedom of the individual and this special set of ideals that this country tries to practice all over. That's our influence. And that, we can talk economics, we can talk trade and all that sort of thing, and I hope we could get a chance to come back and talk about fair trade, because
can you take your shot right now, because we're going to get another question and we have to move on.
Yeah, the answer to the question is yes, the United States will always be, as long as we don't lose sight of the values, as long as in an international and in a domestic sense, we hang on to the things that are most important to us, and that's what this whole debate tonight's all about. We are going to be the leader of the entire world.
Fair trade. Do you want to respond?
It's just a matter of on the trade issue. My.